win in right field today, and he will hit fifth. But we'll start things off. Xander Seacrest gets the start, the senior out of Buford, Georgia, with the ball, the left-hander. Usually it's one of those wait-and-see type things. If they need him on a Friday or Saturday, they'll use him out of the bullpen. If not, he'll get the start on Sunday.
Yeah, it's going to be 85 to 89. Little curve, little change. Creates uncomfortable ABs, and that's just because of the arm slot. It's a little funky. It's adding and subtracting on the fastball, adding and subtracting on the breaking ball. It's going to pitch backwards, you know, breaking balls early, and I think that's going to be a big thing for Tennessee. And both teams, really, because both these teams want to jump on that fastball early. We saw a lot of first pitch home runs so far this series. And so look for pitchers to maybe pitch backwards early and then finish off guys with the fastball.
1-2 to Collins. Ground ball to the right side. They had to shift on. Christian Moore over to first base. And that'll be out number one. And now all eyes will turn to number 24. Charlie Condon coming to the plate, and the numbers are just staggering. 525 average, 19 homers, 40 runs batted in. You'd think he'd have more, but the problem is Corey Collins has been on a home run blast lately, so the bases have been empty for Condon most of the time when he comes to the plate, but the sophomore has done everything and then some for this Georgia offense this year.
Yeah, and you hear those numbers and you're going, okay, you know, 40 at bat. Like, this is his 100th at bat. I mean, you take away some of the walks and everything, but 99 ABs, and he's putting up these types of numbers. It's just unbelievable.
Already 0-2 on Condon, who has 26 walks and just 13 strikeouts. Just misses off the plate.
You know, one thing, Dave, to me, he looks as comfortable as 0-0 as he does 0-2. Like, that just shows you that how good he feels within the strike zone. Because, I mean, he's not even offering it these types of pitches, which, you know, anytime the crowd goes, yeah, it balls a little bit off, but, like, you see hitters start to maybe flinch a swing. He doesn't offer that. He has such good plate discipline and won't really stretch the zone until he feels like he needs to.
The 2-2, it's now 3-2. Seacrest on the year, 24 strikeouts at 18 and 2/3 innings, just 4 walks, making his 7th start this season. Right at the knees, and Colin knew it.
Yeah, nice shot right there by Seacrest, going out there just, hey, I got stuff too, buddy. And then you're right, Condon knew it, and it's one of those where you very often you get a chance to freeze a hitter like that, but it looked like he was looking breaking ball, thinking he was going to try to get him out with it, and sneaks that fastball right down the middle.
3-hole hitter Slate offered. Slate looks at ball one. Slate on the year, 331 average with 8 homers and 31 runs batted in. Slate this weekend, not one of his best weekends, just 2 of 11 at the plate. Has a double and a single this weekend. Despite all that, still hitting 331. Mississippi State transfer pops this one a mile up in the air. Christian Moore will make the catch. So a crisp 1-2-3 inning. That just the 12 home runs, 12 pitchers used. I mean, it's just been a firework display this weekend here in Knoxville.
With 2 of the best pitching coaches in the country in each dugout.
Yeah. It's been a tough weekend for those guys.
Yeah.
Here's Christian Moore, the junior. Second baseman, 349 on the year, 10 homers, 19 runs batted in, 3 hits this weekend. First pitch he sees, delivered out to center field, but there is Charlie Condon to put a glove on it. One pitch, one out.
Now batting the first baseman, number 25, Blake.
Condon has already played 5 different positions for the Bulldogs. He has been anchored out in center field this weekend. as Blake Burke steps into the batter's box. The junior out of Brentwood, California, third year in this Tennessee uniform. 5-for-8 with a home run. That home run tied Luke Lipsius for the career home run record last night, and it was a mammoth shot. Most of Burke's home runs have been mammoth shots.
Yeah, I was going to say that. He doesn't get cheated, especially on the swings, and so when he gets it, it's going to go over the fence. It's not going to be a wall scraper.
Lays off the 94-mile-an-hour fastball up in the zone, 1-1 for Burke. And you've talked about it earlier. I mean, if it wasn't right now for Charlie Condon, he's putting up SEC Player of the Year type numbers with a .410 average, 10 homers, 16 doubles. Can't overlook the extra bases he's been picking up. It's in there for a strike. Hey, he's second on the team in stolen bases. He's got four bags.
Hey, you could be picky and choosy whatever you're ready to run, right?
That's it.
We had a guy, Jeremy Brown, was my catcher, and
yes.
If anybody knows back, I think he left his Alabama four-year career. Nice pitch right there, 94, just on the black painted. But I think he left his Alabama career like only getting thrown out once and had like well over double-digit bags just because you were smart. But that's exactly how you have to pitch Burke. Is just it was early, breaking balls early, and then finishing fastballs late. And that's what you would say, pitching backwards just to kind of get the guys off of seeing a fastball early. You saw Christian Moore jump on that first pitch fastball. Yeah, it's an out, but, hey, he squares it up, so you never know what's going to happen that next at bat.
Three-hole hitter. Dalton Bargo laces this one to right. It bounces over the glove of Logan Jordan, but Bargo, 372. They're glad to have him back in the lineup. Now with a little bit of a hammy issue, and they just slowly worked him back into the rotation and gets the start today.
Yeah, first pitch breaking ball, and that ball's down too. Looking up a little bit, but still, nice job right there. Yeah, they want him back in the lineup. You're talking not a lot of at-bats. That was his 44th AB, and he has 18 RBI. So he's a guy that has a lot of run production in him. He just needs to get those consistent at-bats, but really just stay healthy and stay in that lineup.
Tavares Tears, the designated hitter today, as he gives way to Reese Chapman in the outfield defensively. The sophomore out of Lewisburg, Tennessee, hitting .402 with 8 home runs. Strike one to Tears. The other injury we haven't really talked about that much is Billy Amick, transfer in him. Big get in the transfer portal, has 10 homers, hitting .367. He's out with a bit of an injury, and he had an emergency appendectomy. So he's going to be out perhaps. They're expecting next week as well. It would be almost a minor miracle to see him next weekend, but perhaps the following weekend. It's a big bat to lose out of your lineup. Foul back, 1-2.
Lineup, and that's what you're seeing with these young guys like Bargo, Tears, Curley, these sophomores, Chapman, that are getting their opportunity. It's almost like they have just waves, right? You have those juniors like Moore and Burke who've been here for a while, and then they get drafted and leave, and you got three or four stepping right up into those same spots.
Certainly, they could certainly use a healthy A.J. Russell on the mound. Just four appearances on the year before he steps aside just to get that arm right. Swing and a miss. So a good inning for Georgia. They give up the base hit to Dalton. Got back in with LSU, and now he is running the Georgia program. Dogs will start with Dylan Goldstein, the senior out of Southwest Ranches, Florida. Designated hitter, .324 on the year. Goldstein hitting .500 this weekend, 4-of-8. 3 doubles, 1 run batted in. .123 inning in the first for Xander Sechrist. Got Collins to ground out. Got Condon to strike out. Slade Alford popped it up. Ground ball right side. That'll be foul. Georgia just knocking on the door of the D1 baseball top 25. Welcome to the banks of the Tennessee River at Lindsey Nelson Stadium, literally on the banks of the Tennessee River. Another gorgeous day as we wrap up this three-game series. It is the rubber match between the Vols and the Dogs. Tennessee, the fifth-ranked team in America, put on an offensive display last night to capture game two, 16-11, after being run-ruled on Friday night, the first time they have ever been run-ruled, 16-2, the Dogs. They showed their offensive skills, the top two home run hitting teams in America. This has been a crazy couple of games here in terms of offensive numbers. Dave Neal alongside Lance Cormier, and we expected some fireworks offensively, but I don't think we expected 45 runs, 53 hits, 14 doubles, and 12 home runs in the first two games, but that is what we have. As we are in the top of the second inning, Xander Sechrist has looked really good. He's retired the first four, make it the first five. And three of them are via the strikeout.
Sundays where it was just, you're going to see scores like you saw yesterday. But right now, hey, the way Sechrist is throwing the ball, he's moving the ball in and out, mix in. Who knows? We might have one of those pitcher's duels on a Sunday that very, very rare.
Both guys off to good starts. The 0-1 just off the plate. 1-1. The count to Henry Hunter getting the start behind the plate this afternoon. Henry, 349, four homers and 11 runs batted in. Four doubles as well. Swings and misses here, 1-2.
Yeah, he has definitely been probably, I'd say, way more than 50-50 breaking ball, fastball, but it's really just a lot of breaking balls early, a lot of breaking balls early. He's doing a good job of keeping it away, especially to those lefties, and making them really go out there and fish for it. And then he just kind of lulls him to seat. Just, all right, hey, breaking ball, and then he just tries to sneak in like he did with Cotton and snuck in that fastball, 3-2.
Struck out the side. Impressive start for Xander Sechrist.
You want to go the regular season, not counting some of the postseason. So I would look for that Georgia record of Gordon Beckham 53 to be smashed by Charlie Cotton, just if he continues even remotely at the pace he's at.
Well, we move to the bottom of the second inning. That ball is mashed to right. Will it stay fair or foul? It is a foul ball. Dylan Dreiling, of course, had quite the night last night, this series. Dreiling has put together a .429 average. Three hits, two of them have gone yard with seven runs batted in. Dreiling had a three-run homer in the first last night, answered back with a grand slam. One of two grand slams for Tennessee last night. Bargo had one in the seventh. 93 just misses inside. Maracta had a good first inning, got a fly out, a strikeout, then gave up a single to Bargo, and then came back to strike out Tavares Tears to end the inning. He was sitting 93-94 with his fastball. But here's what Dreiling did yesterday. Well, I didn't know that he got enough of this one, but it does get out of here. Into the first level of the party deck, and then this one with the bases juiced. He knew
he got that.
Yes.
Yeah, we had a stiff wind yesterday, about 14 miles an hour. That's a beautiful comebacker right there. We got a little pitcher duel right now going on, Dave. Four punch outs for Seacrest. That's three for Maracna. Watch that fastball. Little Greg Maddux made that famous into the lefties. And you see that hit start to move, and those lefties raise those arms thinking it's coming inside, and that ball just clips the inside part of the plate.
You know, I look at that pitch, and you're right about the Maddux thing, but Maddux was throwing 87. These guys are doing that at 94. I mean, it's just I don't know how these guys hit today.
Yeah, when you start being able to manipulate the ball and the seams and have that kind of movement, like you're saying, at the velocities that these guys are throwing at, you're right. It starts to think about, like, how do you hit? And so, you know, you get mad at your son going, man, and like, sometimes hitting's hard, Dad. And you're like, yeah, right. It is. Yeah. You forget about how hard it is.
So Dean Curley moves back to shortstop today. The freshman have been playing third the last couple of games, but now that Bargo is back, he fills in at third for the injured Billy Amick. Anthony's 2-1.
Which, Dave, though, like, would make it even more impressive, what we've been talking about is, you know, Charlie Condon's season, is to know that it is that hard to hit. You know, the rule of, we used to learn some things early on. Skip Burton used to preach it, the rule of 63. That was if a guy was hitting 370 as a pitcher, you're going, all right, 63% of the time, he's going to get out. Let me go at him. But this dude's hitting 525, and so it's the rule of 48, and it's getting a little bit tougher. So you're going, how can you be that good when, especially as you seem to see pitcher stuff getting better and better, and you're seeing 94 with movement and all that kind of stuff? It's like, he's just impressive.
And another strikeout at the knees. My goodness. Both of our pitchers are dotting it today.
Well, I love this fastball. Look at the downward plane staying out there. You can pitch down there. That's going to make hitting even tougher, and especially with the velocity 94. Maracna's moving right now.
I mean, both these pitchers have sat on the bench Friday and Saturday night and watched the ball just jump out of the ballpark. It's got to make you go a little crazy, but they do not seem one bit flustered. If anything, maybe they learned, hey, I better keep it down. That one elevated just a touch. Line drive out to right field over the shift. Off the bat of Reese Chapman, who continues to swing it very well for Tennessee here in the last week to 10 days.
Well, he's another one of those young guys that you really got to get some at-bats, because he's got some same type of thing as Bargo. I mean, those are two guys with, they're not even in the qualifying at-bat numbers to be on the team lead, but they both have 38 RBI combined. So that's, those are guys you got to get in there, and it's tough for Coach Vitello to find at-bats, and you're not hopeful guys get injured, but you, when that happens, you do have guys that you could plug into the lineup.
Here's Hunter Ensley, the center fielder, hitting eighth in this lineup. You could use Hunter to pick it up a few notches offensively. Of course, he is just a real leader out in center field for this team, and certainly a big game performer for Tennessee. Three homers and 13 runs batted in, just a .268 average.
But Dave, you mentioned these, you know, the pitchers watching these things, but sometimes you got to be a little stubborn, right? You got to believe in yourself that, hey, they might be getting hits over them, but I'm better than all that. And you go out there and have that kind of confidence, and I think that's what we're seeing by both these starters.
Ensley, the redshirt junior out of Huntington, Tennessee. Been swinging it better heading into this weekend. Had a .375 clip there for a while over a 10-game stretch. He's an excellent football player. Coming out of high school. He was a finalist for both Tennessee's Mr. Football and Mr. Baseball award. He looks at a strike, it's 3-2.
Oh,
Got him. Three strikeouts this inning for Christian Morak. And in 2021, Tony V has got himself a program that is running full tilt. And it's got a renovation going on here at Lindsey Nelson Stadium. It's going to change the entire dynamic and look of this program and the feel of it. Phase one completed earlier, and by the time we get going on the 2025 baseball season, this place will look completely different. Trying to win this series today, though. Ground ball off the bat of Sebastian Murillo to shortstop, where Dean Curley gets to show off his arm. That'll be one down.
Yeah, you talk about Coach Vitale, especially just in the last 4 years, since 2021, and it's 173 victories. That's the most in all of college baseball. And Arkansas, which Coach Dave Van Horn has, he produces a winner every year in the last, what, 20-something years that he's been in Arkansas, and they're 14 games ahead of them. So it just shows you what he has built here. And the guys come here, like he said, now he's starting to bring in guys from all over the country because he goes, people just want to start winning, and when they've seen how much we've won, they want to be a part of it.
Well, Tony was a part of that Dave Van Horn staff for a while at Arkansas. And if you go back to 2017, the Arkansas Razorbacks are the winningest team in the country. But since 2021, nobody's been better in terms of picking up victories than this Tennessee team. Clayton Chadwick, the senior, getting a start today. Clayton out in left field, 281 on the year. And that one's just off the plate. Nice 0-2 pitch that Chadwick takes. 1-2 the count.
And you talked about that 2022 season, which was unbelievable, 57 wins. But that just shows you how hard it is in college baseball to not only win the whole thing, but to get, again, to make it to Omaha. I mean, because that was as good a team as I've seen in a very long time. They had star power on the mound, at the plate, everywhere you look, bullpen, they had it all. And you're thinking, hey, it's guaranteed Omaha, and, you know, probably going to win it all, but still didn't even make it.
Did he go? Yes, he did. Another strikeout for Xander Sechrist.
What a beautiful fastball. Again, we talked about Morakka down in the zone, and he's pitching down in the zone. And look at that, right at the knees, right on the black, little check swing. Not able to hold it up, but both these guys are really doing a good job of moving the ball in and out. But just, you know, mixing the pitches. This is what you want to do as a pitcher. You got to disrupt the timing, and they're both doing a great job.
First pitch to the nine-hole hitter, Colby Branch, in there for a strike. Branch, 5-for-8 this weekend, a 6.25 clip with a home run and a double, 5 runs batted in. Colby, the sophomore at Lucas, Texas, transferred in from Baylor, was a freshman All-American at Baylor last year on a team that just went 20-35. Hit a chopper to short. Curley, long throw, and that'll be a little bit late. That ball must have had some topspin on him, kind of jumped at him a little bit.
Yeah, I think you're right, Dave, just the way that came off the bat, and then as that big long hop, it takes that second one and just shoots right off of him. And that has the making a little topspin right there. Also, it looks like he had it played at him, and then he had to reach across his body a little bit. Getting those shows you see, Chris, down in the zone, getting those ground balls.
Nice little pick over there by Burke. That'll go as an E6 on Dean Curley. And the top of the lineup now, Corey Collins. Collins has reached in his last 15 games the reigning SEC Player of the Week. He was kept in check last night. He did reach base 3 times with 3 walks in the middle of the game. And had a line out, a fly out, and struck out in the ninth. And before last night, to give you an idea of how hot he was hitting .650 over a 5-game stretch with 8 home runs and 19 runs batted in.
Let's go, Corey.
3-0 in there for a strike, 3-1.
19 runs batted in the five-game stretch.
Yeah, is that crazy?
Yeah, that's why, like you said, you mentioned earlier, why Charlie Condon's RBI numbers are not leading the country with everything else that the categories that he's leading is because, like you said, Collins has been clearing the bases.
Senior, not a Swanee, Georgian, his fourth year at the program. He has played 165 games for the Dogs. The ball is hit way up into the air. It'll be caught and left by Dylan Dry. Well, here's Christian Moore. Flew out his first time to center field and looks at a first pitch strike. Ragna has been solid through two innings with five strikeouts. Giving up a couple of singles. Bargo had one, Chapman had one, and now Stark with the bunt. Had some great crowds here this weekend, but as you might imagine, this one might be a little thin considering the Big Orange trying to reach a Final Four, taking on Purdue right now. Leading by three, by the way, midway through the first half. And also congrats to the Alabama Crimson Tide. Don't want to overlook that with Lance sitting here.
Hey, that was a fun game to watch. Both teams are trying to do something they haven't done before, make it to their first Final Four. And my little one was loving life watching that game.
Just off the plate, 2-2. I just got a little video. Chris Burke, great Tennessee volunteer legend on the baseball diamond, sent one of his 29 kids jumping around pregame, got his Tennessee orange on, excited for the basketball game. It's just great to see the excitement. Lined out to Condon. That'll be out number one. That was barreled by Christian Moore, but Charlie didn't have to move very much.
That's the second time Christian Moore is lined out to Charlie Condon. The guy shows he can play some good defense, but man, that's the tough part about baseball, Dave, is when those types of things don't go down as hits, because you can't do anything better than what he's done in his first two at-bats. Got the fastball up, lined it out, but you're still sitting on 0-2.
Here's Blake Burke. Blake struck out his first time against Maracna. See how he adjusted
into that win. So that's what Coach Johnson was saying. He goes, yeah, there was no cheap ones, especially the one Burke hit. He goes, it would have been out no matter what.
117 off the bat. And he is tied. Luke Lipsius, a guy that really kind of mentored Blake. They're now sitting at 40 home runs. Evan Russell in the three hole there with 39, but don't look now. But here's Christian Moore at 37, trying to move up that list.
Well, that list right there also shows you a little bit about, you know, Tony V, right? Where, I mean, four of those guys are, you know, have played under him in the last 5 years. So that just shows you of what he has basically developed here in Knoxville.
So Todd Helton in that list as well. Tennessee two-way player back in the day. Going into the Hall of Fame. The Baseball Hall of Fame this summer. How about him and Frank Thomas? Will be the only two SEC players in the Baseball Hall of Fame. That just blows my mind away.
Yeah, you would think there would be a lot more, but guys have career, you know, guys have good careers. They just haven't had those Hall of Fame careers. And again, that's not an easy thing to do, but that just shows you how special those two guys were.
I was at Auburn yesterday, or last week, and Frank Thomas was in the building. Still looks like he could hit it 500 feet if he wanted to.
On 1 foot.
Throw down to second and safe. Boy, it looked like Branch might have dropped that baseball from our angle. Ryan DeBrower out there at second base. Our umpire was just waiting for a moment to see where the ball was.
Fastball down to the bottom of the zone for the strikeout. You're right, the throw beats him there. But what a slide right there by Stark. The bunt hit, shows a little speed, then he gets a little bag. We'll watch the swim move. Gets under there, and I think you're right though, David. Yep, you see the ball just kind of rolling. That is a nice shot by second base umpire Brian DeBrower, just being right where he needs to be to see that ball down there.
So back-to-back strikeouts of Blake Berkus. A huge moment for Christian Baracna. But now you get to face Dalton Bargo, singled his first time up. Anthony's another strike. Well, he's painting the downside of that, the bottom half of that strike zone today with that fastball.
Yeah, I think just the way Bargo just took that pitch, because that's 0-1 fastball in, you know, especially right where the lefties like it. I think he was thinking breaking ball. That's the pitch he got the first at bat, so that's why I think Miraculous staying hard on him right here.
Got him, and the inning is over. So Bargo goes
yesterday in the game against Auburn, but Condon said, I'll take two.
Condon struck out for just the 14th time of the season, his first time up against Xander Sechrist. Xander with five strikeouts today. That one's up and away, 1-1 to Charlie Condon. Condon's season has just been incredible. He leads the nation, obviously, in batting average, on-base percentage, OPS. He's gone yard 13 of the 27 games he's played this year. Well, that one just misses, 2-2. His slugging percentage is on pace to smash the all-time single-season D1 mark set by Pete Incaviglia at Oklahoma State back in 1985. And right now he's slugging at a 939 clip. If he finishes that high for his career, that would be the best ever in NCAA baseball. Ricky Weeks at Southern University held the mark, has the mark at 927.
Milwaukee Brewers, Ricky Weeks, but
yeah.
I guarantee you Pete Incaviglia had a huge mustache back in 85.
Yeah. That ball's out to right. Is it deep enough to get out of here? Doesn't look like it, as Chapman is there to make a catch.
Had that silver Easton, probably green writing on it.
Yeah.
The old school bat.
He could mash.
I remember going to some Rangers games, just being from South Louisiana. That's kind of one of the teams you could go see close to big league games. Him and Steve Buschel for the Rangers. And they used to chant Inky as he came up.
You know, the Braves had one of those right before Inky, and Bob Horner, for the old school Braves fans, the guy that just he had four homers in one game. I think hit a home run in his opening game from Arizona State. Same kind of guy, just with mash. I mean, compressed baseballs left and right. Defense a little bit left to be desired. Yeah.
The old added nature of, hey, if you hit, doesn't matter how bad the defense is, they'll find a place for you.
Yep. 1-2, the countdown to Slade Alford. That one is hit foul.
Xander Sechrist is trying to make a statement to say, hey, like, don't worry, next time those notes come out, go ahead and pencil in that third star and put my name down, because I'm trying to earn this spot right here.
out to second. Underneath the diving glove of Christian Moore, and that'll be a base hit. That'll be the hit number one for the Bulldogs today.
Boy, right off the bat, I really thought Christian Moore was going to get that. He made two unbelievable plays yesterday in that game we had, so you just expect those types of plays to be made, and the ball goes right under his glove.
Another left-handed hitting Dylan Goldstein, the designated hitter, struck out looking in the second inning. He'll stride to the plate with one out. Goldstein has hit into one double play this year. Check swing, foul ball, 1-1. Xander Sechrist, 6'2", 193 out of Buford, Georgia. Throw back to first. Slade Alford dives back in time. Big Orange basketball team up 5. 6 minutes to go, first half. Two and two.
And the placement of the breaking ball from Sechrist has been really, really good. It looks very similar to the 88 fastball. It's 79 slider. There's not much tilt, but there's just enough breaking away from that left-handed hitter to keep him off of it.
Just misses, now full, 3-2. Say that swing would be defined as defensive.
Well, hey, I mean, that has the swing to make of, like, you're sitting fastball. That's what you're trying to do. You have to stay on the fastball, and then, all right, I think that ball's in the zone, but just, you know, see it deep and slap it foul, kind of waste it, and see if we'll get you another one.
To the right side, and that'll be a base hit. Dogs got a little something going here with one down.
That's a great at-bat right there by Goldstein. Again, was down early, laid off a couple pitches, and then spoiled that one we just talked about, and then that's what you do. You get the pitch up in the zone, middle, and that's the one you can handle, and puts it in the right field for a hit. Now, you said, Dave, dogs have a little spark. Two guys on, only one out.
He looks at a first pitch strike. Out to left, and that is over the head of the left fielder, Dylan Dreiling. Georgia trying to sneak a run home, and can't do it. Oh, It was an awkward play for Slade Alford because he had to hold up to see if this ball was going to be caught.
Yeah, you see him right there at the bottom of the screen, takes the break, puts it on the brakes, thinking he's going. The ball just hit so hard right there by Jordan. But I love the fact, look at that right there. Dreiling just missed it because he almost deeks him in a way, but plays it perfectly off the wall. The relay spot on. Oh, nice pickup right there by Cal Stark.
Wow, that was impressive.
Knowing the runner's coming in on him, a short hop pick with the catcher's mitt. Holds on to it. That's a heck of a play.
Play obviously being reviewed, waiting on the call, but it looked like he got him at the plate from what we have seen.
The throw definitely beat him. It's just a matter of did
after
he
view,
put him.
Called out is confirmed.
Tell you what, we got another good look at the arm of Dean Curley.
Hey,
but the pick was impressive.
Right, and his left foot, Alford's left foot, he slides in. That foot beats it, but it never touches the plate. It just goes right over the plate. And you're right there, the throw, the pick. Hey, got a thankful, you're a little thankful of the turf, maybe? Makes it easier to pick off that turf.
No doubt. Two outs in the inning. George is still with two on. Henry Hunter struck out his first time up. Ground ball to the right side, fielded by Burke. He'll step on the bag, so the Dogs had a chance to strike first, but Xander Sechrist gets some defensive help and gets out of that jam. Into these parts, Kirby Canal. And Kirby, thanks for joining us. You've played a lot of baseball over the years here in Tennessee. Last night you did some things that you had not done before, up over 90 pitches. You went, in terms of a career, the longest outing you have been in terms of innings. How you feeling today?
Yeah, thank y'all for having me on here. You know, I couldn't have done it without the support from my family, my mom, dad, grandparents, brothers, sister-in-laws, nieces, dog at home, Rusty, Fish, Jabari. But no, you know, I feel good. You know, excited to go out here and watch some baseball. You know, if my name gets called today, which probably won't, but, you know, go out there and play ball.
I love it how he says probably won't. 95 pitches. When's the last time you threw that many? And like I said, is the body just, I mean, like, was it hard to wake up this morning with 95 pitches?
Yeah, you know, it was a struggle to get up. Luckily, we played at 2, so I didn't have to wake up as early. But, no, it was a struggle to get up. Body's a little sore, but, you know, just glad to be out here.
You know, with you look at what's going on in this series. The balls are jumping out of the ballpark. I mean, these two teams, both these teams mashed. So when you know your number's getting called, what's your mindset got to be like entering a game like in this particular type of series?
Yeah, you know, both teams can swing it very well. But, you know, our main thing as pitchers is go out there and throw strikes, let defense play behind you. And I think that's what these two guys are going out here and doing right now. You know, we're just sitting here back watching. You know, everybody's out here throwing strikes, a lot of strikeouts. But like you mentioned, there's a bunch of zeros up on the board, but hopefully somebody can change that here soon.
Will Kirby.
There it is.
There you go.
That ball bounces over the wall and right. So the old double. And that'll put Tennessee in scoring position as Tears picks up his eighth double of the year.
I mean, he's been getting the guys with the fastball. It's been down. That ball's up middle, and that's the part about Rackman. He stayed out of the middle part of the plate, and he's been having the success. But Tennessee's hitters, you can't work the middle, especially the fastball. It doesn't matter how hard it is. These guys, they're showing they can turn around any pitch. I mean, we've seen the 98s get turned around, so 94 in middle. Got to be able to work the corners. But, Kirby, talk about just what it feels like to face a guy like Charlie Condon and the season he's having. You know, when you go up there, it's just that one-on-one matchup. What's going through your head when you're facing a guy like that?
Yeah, you know, our mindset, you know, with facing him or facing anybody like him is, you know, with the season that he's having right now is basically, you know, try to work the outer half against him. His hot spots are, you know, middle in. and you leave it over the middle of the play, he's going to deposit it out of the stadium. So
our main thing is basically just, you know, trying to keep the ball in the ballpark.
Well, how about back-to-back base knocks now for Tennessee? Runners at the corners and nobody out in the bottom half of the fourth inning. Hey, Kirby, you've had a long career at Tennessee. When you go back to the 2020 season and your first year wearing the orange to where you are now, like, what are your biggest takeaways about this program and where it's gone?
Yeah, you know, I think the coaches have done a great job of, you know, just, you know, providing us with all the support and all the information that we need going into it. We do a great job in the fall of, you know, just going out there working every single day, trying to get better. And, you know, our main thing is, you know, once we get out on the field, you know, we're going to play ball like little kids. So just going out there, you know, doing what we do, doing what they recruited us to do, and go out there and play baseball like we know how to.
You know, obviously, you have become a cult hero around Knoxville, and most of the folks that follow SEC baseball certainly know of you. But last night we're watching, the mustache certainly stands out, but what's up with the cuffs, rolled up pants? I mean, I got to ask you about where did that come from? What's up with that?
I used to roll my pants on the inside, but this year, you know, I really just wanted to, you know, change it up a little bit and roll it up on the outside. And, you know, some pants do it, some of them won't do it, but, you know, just, I kind of like having my pants a little high, but I don't look very good when I have my pants all the way up above my knees, so I like to go with the tweener look.
All right, well, listen, let me tell you something. I got a left-handed pitcher right now, a senior in high school, and if he busts out the rolled-up pants, I'm blaming you.
That's fine.
You'll take it. You'll wear that one.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Kirby, it's been great watching your career. I know we'll see you a bunch more moving on, but continued success and good luck after baseball.
Yes, sir. Thank you all for having me on here, and happy Easter.
Same to you, buddy. Well, Georgia makes a pitching change, and we'll step aside as well. Come back to Knoxville right after.
Important they feel this game is, especially with zeros on the board, is, you know, two quick barrels and trying to get to somebody new, because that's one of those where you pitch out of it, you give up one or two runs, you know, heck, you're a ground ball away from a double play, give up one and being able to move on. But Coach Johnson must see something, because, I mean, the first three innings, he was as good as it comes.
They turn it over to a young man who's only thrown two innings this year, Coleman Willis, the big right-hander. Pitched against Tennessee last year, went one inning, two strikeouts and a walk. Actually, that was back in 2022. Six-seven frame. Bumps it a strike, 3-1. Coleman out of Warner Robins, Georgia. Went to Houston County High School, big powerhouse in baseball in the state of Georgia. Lifted in the air, Condon there to make a catch. Will this be deep enough as he charges? And the runner will hold up as that one drifted to shallow center field. It's another. Meanwhile, this Arkansas team looking every bit the number one team in the country.
Dave, you mentioned hands full about Kentucky trying to go on the road, sweep Ole Miss, up 5-0 going to the bottom of the first.
Wow. Arkansas just swept LSU this weekend. Foul, 2-1 the count. Yeah. Chapman singled his first time up. Chapman has raised his average to 424. Chapman making just his 10th start of the year, his 20th game played. That one's up and away, and it's 3-1 now. And that allows Dylan Dreiling to get to second base. Tears over at third. And the crowd called for a balk, and they got it. I'll tell you what, Henry Hunter not happy about it. See what he did here.
It's got to be that he didn't stop, but I thought he paused just enough. Yeah, I think Henry Hunter's yelling, like, don't let the dugout, don't let the fans call it. A lot of times you'll see guys just keep coming set and they don't really stop. He's going to make it, obviously, pause right there.
Oh, this ball is blistered to center field, but not enough. This will be an easy tag up and score, and the Vols will now have a 2-0 lead.
Got to give a lot of credit right there to Dreiling. Two pitches before that, take second base on the 6-7 righty, wasn't paying attention, and all of a sudden a ball moves into third base, and now allows you to get that easy sack fly run, and guy runs too well. Condon was deep, tried to make a good throw to it, but yeah, too much speed for Dreiling. But that all started with the stolen base two pitches before that.
For a strike to start this at bat to Hunter Inslee. Popped up out of play, 0-2. Inslee struck out his first time up as Tennessee has scratched first here at the bottom of the fourth inning. Ground ball. Scooped up there at second by Murillo, but nothing he could do about it as Inslee beats the throw to the bag.
Oh, a heck of an effort right here. Just a great pitch and jams him. And Murillo, look at that sliding. Thought the turf was going to help him out, but just too much speed. So think about it, Dave. I talked about Christian Moore squaring up two balls, and he's 0-for-2. And then you get a jam shot like this. You perfectly place it, and that can go down as a hit.
Cal Stark laid down a perfect bunt his first time up. Willis in that 91-94 range with that fastball. There's a strike, 2-2. Purdue and Tennessee at the half. Boilermakers lead it by two. They went on a nice little run. Tennessee was up 11, but they trailed by two at the break. A lot of umpires today here at Lindsey Nelson Stadium. I don't know how, I mean, I certainly appreciate our umpires. I don't know how they listen to some of the stuff they have to listen to. My gosh. Oh,
there's just a lot of nonsense.
It's a good way to put it.
Good. You could have hoped for Xander Seacrest, especially there's a lot of strikeouts early and the stuff's not quite as sharp, and I think that's why you've seen the strikeout have continued to pile up, but he's been getting the outs when he needs to, and big defensive play behind him. Caught a run at home, and that's what you, when you make a nice defensive play, all of a sudden come in, offense scores a couple runs. Now this, your job is to go out there and put up a zero. Don't let that inning become not a shutdown inning.
It'll be 7-8-9 coming up for Georgia. Sebastian Murillo, Clayton Chadwick, and Colby Branch. Murillo looks at a first pitch strike. Murillo 0-for-1 today. Down in the zone. Seacrestus, 43 strikes. He's been pumping the strike zone today. Had a really good slider working. Of activity up there in that Tennessee bullpen area. Nate Sneed getting loose. We saw Nate last night. Nate hit 101 on a couple of pitches last night.
I think you kind of just know what's kind of looming. If a couple guys get on, you know who you're going to have to face. And that's the part about where most guys would think about hitting Condon maybe in that three, even four slot, but him in the two slot knows if you get any kind of guys at the bottom of the lineup to get on base, he's going to come up. So this inning being the fifth after you just scored, I mean, he is looming. You know, one or two guys get on, you're going to have to face him.
Out to right. Shy of the warning track goes Reese Chapman, that'll be out number one. How was it, Lance, pitching back-to-back days? Was there a certain point, was there a number you had in your mind, 30 pitches, 40 pitches, where you just felt like maybe you couldn't go the next day?
Yeah, a lot of it was just on how you felt, obviously, but that goes to how much do you warm up. And I think that's where teams are starting to pay attention more on how many when you're warming up, how many times you get up. Like if the coach calls, hey, we need somebody getting loose into third, well, up, sit back down, he got out of it, and not wasting many pitches. And I think that's the toughest part of high school kids going to college that have never thrown in the bullpen. They truly don't know how many pitches it takes for them to get loose. You know, that is a skill that you'll learn the more you do it.
Base hit there from Clayton Chadwick.
And I like the fact that if I was going to go back-to-back and especially maybe extend something, you know, you obviously want to get the shorter outing on the first day where you don't throw too much and then you're able to extend maybe that second day, kind of like Snead did. You know, if he comes in, it's not necessarily a one-inning stint. He might be able to go two-ish, maybe even three on the backside. But if you go think about Georgia's closer Zeldin last week. You had it the game where he goes four innings on Saturday to finish the game, and he actually came back on Sunday to finish it off. It's like that's a tough go when you throw that many on one day and then try to come back with it.
Yeah, man, it's just, I guess each guy's a little different in that regard as well.
Absolutely. I mean, some guys really, they throw, if they get hot and everything, they take 2 days to get ready. And then, some, you know, to feel better or in their mindset to feel like, hey, I'm where I need to be. And there's just some guys that can throw every day where they, you know, I think more of the max effort guys are like that. Can't throw every day as the guys that just kind of get through the innings and everything and maybe are sitting at a 90-ish to 95% type pitching instead of all-out effort.
Kirby Cannell, we talked to earlier, he's one of those guys that would throw every day if you let him. Matter of fact, I bet if you asked him if he wanted to pitch today, he'd take the ball right now and run out there for a few batters after throwing 95 yesterday.
He even kind of said, well, I don't think I'm going to throw. I would say, thank you. There's no way you're throwing today.
Here's Corey Collins. The lineup flips again. Two outs and a runner on. 0 for 2 today. Collins with 12 home runs. What a find he has been in that leadoff spot for the Bulldogs in front of Charlie Condon. Throw back to first. Chadwick gets back. But, you know, it's interesting. You know, we've talked a lot about his power numbers last week with those 8 home runs in 5 games and 19 runs batted in. But he did go 0 for 3 last night. But you know what? He got on base 3 other times via the walk.
Yeah, I mean, the power's there, but it's 396, and the on-base percentage is 603. Like, you'll take that any time from the leadoff spot, right? You know, if it's one of those things where if he keeps that up, I wonder if, and maybe Alford's production dips a little bit, like, do they shift and does he go behind? Because sooner or later, Charlie Condon's going to need, you know, protection behind him. Teams are just going to stop pitching to him if there's anybody on base. Right here, you need to go tell Chadwick, like, hey, you have a one-way lead. You're not going to get picked off. You're not going to get thrown behind because we're going to take the chance to bring Charlie Condon up with two guys on.
Kyle Stark liked where that 0-2 pitch was. Collins wasn't biting. Condon on deck, 0 for 2 with a strikeout and a flyout. Would love a chance with runners on here in the fifth. Got it. Called strike 3. Inning is over. Making an appearance. DeVito, his 6th appearance of the year. 7 innings of work. 5 strikeouts. 4 walks. Opponents hit 125 against him.
Fastball is going to be 80 to about 90s. Got some high leverage back into the bullpen experience, being former closer at Tulane.
Had to wait his time to get back on the field, really, to go full throttle. Only threw 14 innings last year after having what they call internal brace procedure at the end of the 22 season on his throwing arm. Did you ever have arm surgery? Elbow, shoulder?
No, I did not. I was able to stay away from the knife. Little tendonitis freshman year, but that was probably from throwing a lot in high school, a lot in that summer, then, you know, throwing a lot in college that first year, more than I'd ever thrown. And then, for the most part, no other real injury until the end of the career.
Throw over to first in time for out number 1. We were listening to some of the pregame announcements, and Tennessee hits 2 home runs in a game, whether it's softball or baseball, fans get a free Chick-fil-A sandwich. They've been giving away a lot of sandwiches. Blake Burke looking for his first hit today, has a couple of strikeouts. His average down to 402. 92 from DeVito, fouls it straight back. Burke getting a little frustrated at the plate.
Yeah, I was about to say the same thing. He just doesn't look comfortable. You know, and his mindset's already got the two punch outs, knows he's riding that big hitting streak of 18 games and just seems to be finding himself in disadvantaged counts every time he steps up to the plate.
Up the middle, backhand there by Murillo over to first. That'll be out number two.
Now batting the third base, number 16, Dalton.
Analytics goes these days. That's, you know, a couple years back, that's a hit for some of these guys. I thought off the bat it was going to be there, and Murillo was just perfectly placed, and this shows you, you know, tendencies. The scouting departments at all these schools, especially the top Power Five schools, and be able to look at these, you know, spray charts of where guys hit it and put guys right in the right spot.
Here's Bargo. Looks at ball one. Let me ask you this as a baseball guy. So George had the shift on over there. So Colby Branch was over on that side. Do you score that? Because that ball was hit to second base. Do you score that as a 4-3, even though the shortstop fielded it? How would you score that?
Yeah, I think it would go down as the 6-3 because it's the guy playing short.
And this is going to go down as an HR, as a home run. Bargo goes yard for the fourth time this year.
Well, you talked about the Chick-fil-A. You had no home run so far, Bargo. A man might be hungry, even though the Chick-fil-A's closed on Sundays, but wants to get him a little bit closer. Fastball comes in, and again, that's the happy zone right there for the lefties. Does a nice job of keeping the hands in, and just explodes on that ball. Look at it. And then once he knows off the barrel, he knows that's out of here.
First home run of the day. Had eight of them last night. Had four on Friday night in game one. Bargo also picks up his 19th RBI of the year. Tavares Tier swings out in front of that one, 0-2. Interesting to see if they run Sechrist back out there in the top of the sixth inning.
With Charlie Condon coming up the third time, Sechrist really hadn't seen lineups, you know, flip three times on him. So, but I mean, he's throwing the ball really well.
That one is out to left, gonna drop in there for a base hit.
They might see what they can get out of it just to see, hey, each out is precious. So can he go out there and get another out? And if he gets one, maybe give him another. And as long as the arm still feels good, you know, he's communicating with the staff that, hey, I still feel good. And if that's the case, then you trust him because he's throwing the ball well.
Well, if you're working off averages in baseball, that's you know, you do a lot of that. You would think the Condon's do. Came in hitting 525 and is 0 for 2 to start the day. So when Condon grabs his bat, you'd think he'd be due for that base knock. No matter who's in there.
That's true.
Here is Charlie out in center field.
No matter what, they send him out there. They send him not in. He gave Tennessee everything he had on this Sunday when they really needed it, just because of the way the bullpen was used yesterday and Beam not having a good start. So he's been impressive and trying to stake that claim to, hey, just go ahead and put me in there as that third starter.
Second and third.
No, Dave, I like Dylan Dreiling. I like the swing. It's short, it's compact. Seems to barrel most balls up in there. They just right straight to the ball. You're right, right through that shift. Again, though, that's just, he's one of those guys that you're not thinking about when the Tennessee lineup, because you have the names like Christian Moore, Blake Burke, and Billy Amick. And when you're not having to face those, you get some kind of production from the bottom part of the order of the young guys. It's like, hey, that's just a positive, but he's turned into be a.
So Dean Curley, 0-for-2 with a strikeout. Volunteer shortstop. 8 homers and 27 runs batted in on the year. First pitch, he sees 93 from Roberge. Transfer out of New Hampshire. Josh is quite entertaining in the dugouts for this team. He's has a psychology degree from Wheaton College and a master's in developmental psychology from Southern New Hampshire. I'm sure he's a lot of fun to talk to in the dugout.
he's playing mind games with you, and he's right. Dissecting you, what you're saying and what you look like.
There's a little chopper tipped off the glove. Nice play at second base from Sebastian Murillo. So Roberge gets the does come back out. His career high in terms of innings, 5 2/3. And the first man he starts off with, the nation's leading hitter, Charlie Condon, who's 0-for-2 with a strikeout and a flyout today. Out to straight back. Here's the heat map for Charlie Condon.
Safe to say he should stay out of that middle.
Yes. Popped him up. Christian Moore on the shortstop side of things makes the catch. And Condon down for the third straight time. Charlie went 1-for-4 on Friday, 5-for-6 last night. But 0-for-3 so far on this Sunday.
Yeah, Dave, I'm telling you, I can see Xander Seacrest with the outing he has going in. He walks into that dugout and says, I want him again. He knew he was coming up.
He might be the only guy in the country that says, I want Condon right now. Well, he's done his job. Now Slade Alford. He looks at a first pitch strike. For Xander, this is his 30th career start with a senior at a Flowery Branch High School in Buford, Georgia. He's made 56 appearances in his Tennessee career and has a career ERA of 2.21, which ranks first nationally among active pitchers. That 2.21 career ERA, I mean, that's pretty impressive stuff. Opponents for his career have hit just 219 against him.
That is crazy impressive, the 2.21 ERA. Especially bouncing around from the starting role to the bullpen, back to the starting role.
Yeah, 26 relief appearances. 29 starts. And he's doing something that, at least to this point, that nobody else has done this year against these Georgia hitters. Georgia has at least one extra base hit in all 27 games coming into today, but they have yet to get that extra base hit. Swing and a miss, strikeout, out number two.
Well, sometimes, Dave, when it's going good, it's going good. This is a breaking ball up in the zone, up out over the plate. And I love the catcher's reaction. When your catcher, look, it means something to him right there. Cal Stark with the big fist pump. Tying his career high with 5 2/3.
And now 7 strikeouts. The other big number is no walks today. So for his career, he has 120 strikeouts in his career and just 17 walks.
Man, that's amazing, because your thought and your hope is to try to be 3-1. And that's kind of winning baseball. You know, you'll see guys be a lot, you know, higher. Okay, 5-1, but like to be right there, that's outstanding. Just say commanding the zone. He does a good job. We mentioned he's throwing the breaking ball off the plate where he needs to and keeping guys off balance.
Underhand toss. And
all right, fans.
Xander Seacrest just moved to the bottom of the six. To the right side. And that'll be out number one as Chapman is retired.
Now batting the center fielder, number 9, Hunter Ensley.
So Hunter Ensley coming to the plate. Hunter, strikeout and a single. Florida comes back to beat Mississippi State 4-3. Jack Caglione doing Jack Caglione things down there for the Gators, pitching and hitting today. lifted in the air. That'll be playable for Clayton Chadwick, out number two.
Good day. 5 2/3 on the mound. Gives up 3 runs, so he was on the hook. Struggled a little bit with command, 4 walks in his 5 2/3, but he is that guy that gets to hit too. And so, you know, you always hear the thing, hey, help yourself out. So that's what he decided to do. He at the plate goes 1 for 2 and 3 walks, but the one was a big one. It's a 2-run walk-off home run in the bottom of the ninth. And so they were able to, he's able to get himself off the hook for that loss.
It always helps like, when you're in control of those things.
Absolutely. And just shows you how impressive the season Condon's having, because we're not talking about this guy who's
right.
Unbelievable, you know, has had a really good season on the mound, but has also been really, really good at the plate.
He is, Jack Caglione is 7th in the league in batting average, hitting .387. He's got 12 jacks, 27 runs batted in. On the mound, he is 4th in ERA, 1.65. Now that'll go up after today's performance, giving up some runs in that game. But 3-0 on the mound in 27 innings of work. I mean, it's as far as two ways go, hard to beat those numbers. Ground ball, and that will be a base hit to the left side. Probably get extra bases. Kyle Stark with his second hit today. His first double of the year.
Coach Vitello pushing all the right buttons, giving Cal Stark another chance to get out there and get the lineup. And he's helping him out. He said the bunt single. He even had a big stolen base. And I guess that double inside the line right there, trying to earn a little bit more playing time.
And it flips the lineup back to Christian Moore, looking for his first hit today, 0 for 3. Burrs has a unique resume in the fact that he's played in both the Division II and the Division III World's College Baseball World Series. I wonder if he'd be the first guy, if Georgia was able to get to Omaha this year, would he be the first guy to play in all three of those? Division I, Division II, and Division III?
I would go out on that limb and say absolutely.
Yeah. Right. Until we're proven otherwise.
Right.
This is his 7th year of college.
Well said, he's a future coach, wants to be a coach once his playing career is over. And you know, as a pitcher, felt like, hey, his Coach Johnson, good guy to learn from, and so gonna soak it all up. I like the stuff though, man. It's up to 94 with a nice little breaking ball, so who knows, might have to put off coaching for a little bit.
Away. Here's the throw down to first. They'll get the out. I don't think Christian Moore realized that ball got away, and that'll end the inning. 10 set earlier this year. And he is at a career-high 6 innings pitched and working on his 97th pitch of the game, and it's just off the plate.
But Dave, in the open, he talked about uncomfortable at-bats and just how he creates that. And it's a little funky slot, especially to the lefties, but he's done a good job. We've seen curveballs, we've seen sliders, seen changeup, big punch out on Cordy Collins. I think it was to finish, the fifth inning, where he threw a changeup, shook off 3 times for a changeup. So he's shown a 4-pitch mix, moved the ball in and out, up and down. I mean, that's exactly what you want to do.
There for a strike, 2-1. Seacrest has set Georgia down 1-2-3 times today. Georgia in the first two games only went down 1-2-3 once. That was in the first inning of game one. A check swing foul off the bat of Jordan. And the 100th pitch of the game. The last time Georgia was shut out was last year in the SEC baseball tournament, day number one against South Carolina. Lost 9-0 in a 9-inning game. And that is the first walk of the day. I just wonder how much longer they'll ride with Seacrest after that walk. Nate Snead still warming up for Tennessee. An inning and a third, 2 hits, 1 run. 2 strikeouts, no walks last night. This could be 2 on his first pitch, and it is. That's a gut punch for the Dogs.
Yeah, in that pitcher's exchange when they were chained, I saw Cal start talking with Christian Moore. It looked like his head was down a little bit, and Cal looked to be the leader, was trying to kind of pick him up, and then right there, first ball goes right to Christian Moore, a little 4-6-3, and I saw Stark pointing at him out there like, hey, look, I told you, it's coming to you, you're going to find it, you're going to make the play, and that's a good leadership right there by the catcher.
1 pitch and 2 outs. Sebastian Murillo, 0-for-2 today. His average has dipped down to 318. Lifts that one up in the air. Can anybody catch up to it? Inslee, yes! What a catch! What a catch for Hunter Inslee. Blake riding an 18-game hit streak. 0-for-3 today with a couple of punch outs. Starts him off, ball one. Jarvis, outstanding two-way high school player, football and baseball. Evans actually had some big offers to play quarterback from Maryland and Boston College, but grew up going to Georgia football and baseball games, so it was an easy sell to get him to Athens. Look at that mound. It's the only dirt on the field. Some schools go all turf, including the mound, like Vanderbilt, for instance. Slapped to the left, and the streak is alive. Leadoff single for Blake Burke here in the bottom of the 7th.
Now batting the third baseman, number 16.
Okay, this is a guy, we've talked about the average thing, but I mean, a big, powerful left-handed hitter. I mean, he hits 300. I think this is now puts him at 300 on the year against left-handed pitching. Most times guys will struggle a little bit against that left-on-left matchup, but Blake Burke is just showing you, and he also crushes right-handed pitching as well, but does a nice job of staying in on those lefties, and that's why Jarvis is in, because you got 4 lefties in a row, but Burke extends that hitting streak.
Bargo, a couple of hits today, including a solo shot, his fourth of the year. Well, good job by Hunter behind the plate. Elevate in a hurry and save that one from going to the backstop.
Yeah, that boy, it looks like he just kind of babied that a little bit. You see, he kind of looks at his hand, sometimes slips a little, but you're right, athletic play by the catcher.
Swing and a miss on a bad pitch. Good pitch, I guess, if you're Jarvis out there.
Yeah, you'll take that. I mean, that's a 2-0, I'm swinging no matter what it is type of swing.
Center field, Condon, short of the warning track, makes the catch. That'll be out number one.
Now batting the designated hitter, number 21, Kavaris Tears.
Here comes Kavaris Tears to the plate. Has a couple of hits today, a double and a single, scored a run. Big looping breaking ball in there for a strike.
Breaking balls right there. It shows a little slider and a curveball. The first one just a little get me over, and that's what you got to do being a left-hand reliever in this league. You've got to be able to come in and flip that breaking ball for a strike, because most hitters won't swing at that first pitch.
Seats. I love that area right there at the corner, kind of facing the field a little bit. If I couldn't sit behind the plate, I think I'd like to go right there.
I agree with you. Nice chair backs. Look comfortable.
Man. That looks like the deal right there now.
Got you a chance for a foul ball.
You got the party deck right there to your left, short distance. Swing and a miss. Another big looper from Evans. That'll be out number two as Tears goes down swinging. Yes, that's a setup right there. I could get used to right there.
Wait. You got a Georgia jersey and a Tennessee hat.
There's a lot going on there.
He's got some explaining to do. You did say it was a nice loopy pitch. I mean, that was the slow breaking ball. So showcasing both of them, that's a great way to attack the left-handed part of this lineup.
A great way to attack that hot dog, too, right there. Just go get it. Don't be shy. Dreiling awaits the 1-0, and that's in there. It's 1-1. Charlie also with two hits today, a single and a double, and he scored a run. Boy, Jarvis almost threw it over Collins' head. One and two. Dryling lays off. Two and two. Now it's run full, three and two.
It's a huge stop right there. Just so casual, nonchalant on that pick. I mean, if that ball rolls up a little bit, Burke takes second base, you get a man in scoring position with two outs, and then a hit can obviously extend that lead where you want it to be, a four-run lead where a grand slam can't beat you.
Fastball fouled off. Lifted out to center field. Condon on the run, and that's going to drop in for a base hit. And with two outs, Tennessee will have him at second and third, right into the no man's land behind the bag at second that nobody could get to.
Yeah, it's such a tough spot. Just off the bat, sounds a lot better. Just one of those where just not deep enough. I don't know if you could throw it in a better spot right there and just really put it in where nobody can get to it. Well, Bloop double.
Wes Johnson coming out to the mound.
Pulling zero ERA.
And Dean Curley, the freshman shortstop. Starts him off with a little slow one at 79. Radke had some kind of high school career, Blessed Trinity High School. He went through his senior year and did not give up a run. Had 108 strikeouts in 54 innings and a 0.00 ERA.
That's crazy. That's one of those where you just think bad luck, you're going to give up something. You know, a couple bloops right here and a walk later, and man.
Now 3-1. That'll make any pitching coach a little hot under the collar coming out of the bullpen and walking the first man you see. And now the bases are loaded.
Well, especially when you got a guy that has that kind of arm and powerful arm that comes in there. I know the coaches are called pitches, but.
Well, the Vols have them loaded with two outs. Reese Chapman. Hit by Radke. That'll bring the fourth run of the game home.
But it looks like another off-speed pitch. Obviously, it's the changeup right off the bat. Hooks it just a little bit. Chavis said, I'll take that. It's an RBI, just easy.
Hunter Inslee. With the bases loaded. Two and two now. One. 67-60 Purdue out in front. Minute 45 left in Detroit. That ball shot out to left. That'll get one in. That'll get two in. And the Vols will have them second and third. And it's now a 6-0 Tennessee lead. Inslee picks up RBIs 14 and 15.
It's just been all-speed pitch after all-speed pitch. Another little slider in the zone right there. And Inslee, that ball comes in, backs up a little bit, keeps the hands in, drives that ball, gets him a double, two RBI. Extends this lead for Tennessee. But it's a plus slider, so look for, especially with guys in scoring position, look for that to be the go-to pitch.
Misses inside, 95 right out of the gates. Good-looking, crisp breaking ball from Gillespie. Tapper. Throw to first is in time, and that'll end the inning. So Gillespie does his job, but Tennessee adds to their lead. It's now 6-0 Vols after seven. Look at our game summary. Georgia 4-for-24 at the plate. Zero extra base hits. The last time Georgia didn't record an extra base hit in the game was March 5th of last season against Georgia Tech. And 72 straight games with at least one extra base hit. Meanwhile, Sechrist was fantastic on the bump. Bargo had a solo homer in the fifth. And they have, again, hit well with two outs, 9-of-16. Georgia is nothing today in terms of two out hits, and they have been really good the first couple games in that department.
Yeah, that's exactly right, Dave. 11 yesterday, I think they were 11 for 20 with two outs, but it comes down to, right, what's the nature of how you win? You get good starting pitching and timely hitting, and that's exactly what Tennessee's gotten today.
Chadwick behind 0-2 to start things off for Georgia. Here at the top of the eighth inning, Clayton singled his last time up. One for two today. Out to left, slicing to the left fielder. Dylan Dryling is there to make the catch. So one down, the nine-hole hitter, Colby Branch, coming to the plate. Branch has reached on an error and flown out. And then the lineup will flip to Corey Collins. And if one can reach, Charlie Condon will take a swing here in the eighth. Nate Sneed on the mound. Like that, 3-0 to Colby Branch. That'll be out of play, and bad news for those Tennessee fans. They fall to Purdue, 72-66. Purdue making their way for the first time since 1980 to a Final Four. Meanwhile, Tennessee's streak of 25 straight tournaments without a Final Four appearance continues. So close, but yet so far for the Vols. Heck of a season, though.
Yeah, that was. You talk about SEC Player of the Year, Dalton Connect, and he did his part, 37 points, but it was a star-powered game. Zach Eady threw up 40. And that dude's a load, so it's going to be one of those where you got to be able to stop him, but that was a back-and-forth game where two of the best players in the country going head-to-head.
Top of the lineup now for Georgia. Their top four hitters today, just 2 for 12, just two singles. First two games, top four, had 6 doubles, 4 home runs, and 12 runs batted in. Collins 0 for 3. To left, and that'll drop for a base hit. Back-to-back singles now for the Dogs, and here comes Charlie Condon with two on, and he is definitely due for a hit. He's 0 for 3 today. A strikeout, a fly out, a pop-up. And he turned around one of Sneed's 98-mile-an-hour fastballs last night and hit it off the batter's eye. Starts him off 86 just off the plate. Oh, that was fouled off. Cal Stark looked like he just missed his chest protector.
Why guys want to catch, I don't know. That's just, you get beat up. And it's kind of forgotten, too. Like, after about 2 or 3 pitches, everybody in the whole place is going to have forgotten about that except Cal Stark.
There's a strike, 1-2. Condon this season has yet to go 0-for-4 in a game.
This is what you don't see very often. It's not the pitch that Nate Steve wants. It's a slider. You just kind of see his reaction, like, I'll take it. But slider up and out of the way. Condon's just swinging. It's one of those days. Sometimes you're going to have those. Obviously, he doesn't have them very often. But I think that was a little frustration from the pitch before where he thought it was off the plate.
Frustration in that Georgia dugout. And now it's up to Slade Alford with two outs. He looks at a first pitch strike.
Very close to the same type of pitch that he called even this at bat and also the one on Condon. So you can see why the Georgia dugout has been a little upset with the strike zone this inning.
Two and two. Do it again. Snead up to 25 pitches. Threw 26 last night. That might have been ball four. Tennessee dugout. Some high fives from teammates.
You can tell just from looking at that's a dugout winning 6-0 and not losing 6-0.
Out to right. Playable there. Maurice Chapman, and that'll do it for Georgia.
Top part of the East going, hey, depending on how Florida plays, but if you can kind of hold serve, and that might be one of Kentucky's first true test.
Cats off to a great start, only one loss in league play. Christian Moore, top of the lineup for Tennessee here in the bottom of the eighth. Well, Kentucky's just hammering Ole Miss now. It's 11-1. Game in the sixth inning. Kentucky last night put up 17 on Ole Miss pitching. They won 17-9. On Friday, Kentucky won 5-3. Ground ball to third. And the ball pops out. Collins can't hang on to it, and the runner is safe.
Typical rollover, all through. Little sidearm, the ball runs on him. I thought Collins did a great job of going out and getting it. Goes at with more as he runs through it. Just where you run hard, the ball just pops out of his glove.
And now you get a runner on for this guy, Blake Burke. There was an error on Alford over at third base. Blake Burke singled his last time up, 1-for-4 today with a couple of strikeouts. Oh, 2.
No, Dave, it looked like last three plate appearances for Christian Moore, especially that one, he was just in between pitches, and a lot of that could be frustration from the first two at-bats where he squared the ball up and had nothing to show for it. Then you kind of play those in your head, and it was late on the fastball, early on the breaking ball, and just not putting together good at-bats. But he'll probably take that when you take an 0-for-5 with your team's up 6-0 because everybody else is doing some damage.
Boy, Burke has done damage all year at the plate for Tennessee. Hanging in there, fouling off a couple of pitches. Ole Miss, by the way, finishing up that thought on the Kentucky Ole Miss series. Ole Miss will be 3-6 after today, and then they've got to go face number one Arkansas Thursday, Friday, and Saturday in Fayetteville. That time, Hunter able to hang on to it, and Burke strikes out for the third time today.
That was a nice job, Gillespie. The breaking ball is down the pitch before that, and then he climbs the ladder. That's where the Georgia pitchers, when they've had success against Burke, it's been above the belt, right under that falls across his chest. That's kind of where you got to pitch to him. Future Vol right there.
Ready to swing it. Always be ready to swing. It reminds me seeing that young man swing about a spring training thing last year about a player who was just trying to get a feel for the game. They knew he wasn't going to hit, but he went to the batter's box, I don't know, 5-6 times and walked like 4 or 5 times. And they knew, everybody knew he wasn't swinging. He just wanted to see live pitching. Swing and a miss, and that one gets all the way back into by the Georgia dugout, and there'll be no throw. But a runner was first, so first was covered up, less than 2 outs, so that'll go down as a strikeout.
Yeah, that was the Dodgers, right? I think I can't remember the kid's name, but it was a young kid. Just could have gone up there with no bat still. He walked way more than you would have thought. That just shows you that it is hard to throw the ball over the plate sometimes, because knowing a guy won't swing the bat and you still can't throw 3 straight strikes.
I mean, it was like he walked 4 or 5 at-bats or 5 of 7 or something. It was something like you're like, what? This is professional pitchers. That ball is touched out to right, and it'll one-hop right in front of Logan Jordan. And that'll get the seventh run home.
I think Barco's going to earn some more plate appearances. This is one of those where he keeps going after it. Is that tears? That might be a little bit off. No matter who it is, it's pretty swing.
Pinch runner. Radke Lowry. Running over at first base. My third hit of the day for Tears. Dreiling today has three hits as well. Two doubles, single. Couple of runs scored. That was after yesterday's two home run performance and seven RBIs. Strike at 2-1. Tennessee trying to push their conference record to 5-4. They'll be tied with South Carolina and Florida at 5-4. Kentucky up big, of course, trying to go to 8-1. Vanderbilt with a sweep this weekend. They now 6-3. And they have won 5 in a row. Is a walk to Dylan Dreiling, and that'll get us to Dean Curley.
Now batting the shortstop, number 23, Dean Curley.
So Curley walked and scored his last time up. He's 0-for-3 in total today. Awkward swing. He's behind 0-1. It's 0-2. Curley became the sixth Tennessee player and the first freshman to hit three home runs in a game, which he did against Kansas State earlier this year. Had 9 RBIs in that game, which is a freshman record. Tied for third nationally among freshmen with 8 home runs. Tied for first in the league among freshmen in home runs. Didn't even take the bat off his shoulder, and that'll do it. Georgia down 7-0 in the final 3 outs. When we come, here's what Georgia has coming up. Of course, the Dogs will take on Mississippi State next weekend in Starkville to Short. Curley's throw to Burke in time. But yes, Mississippi State, then they get Missouri at home, Ole Miss at home, and then they're on the road at Texas A&M. They'll finish the season May 16th through 18th, hosting Florida. Talking to Wes Johnson about what it's like to be the man in charge as opposed to the pitching coach. And he says the biggest thing is just the time you got to spend doing all the other stuff. Like talking to us for 30, 45 minutes.
Right. Radio interviews, these Zoom calls for these meetings. It's sometimes guys just want to, hey, I just want to do what I do and scout pitch, you know, scout the hitters and create approaches on how we're going to attack hitters. And yeah, that's the beauty of being the head coach. You become more of the CEO.
Three and one now. Ground ball to the left side, fielded there. And a nice throw by Dalton Bargo. So Goldstein and Jordan are retired. Now it's up to Henry Hunter to keep it going. Well, Tates will actually hit for Henry Hunter. Tates got the start last night out in right field for the Bulldogs. A lot of stories here. Tennessee, of course, bouncing back after getting run ruled on Friday night. And they will win this one. A Sneed underhand toss. And Tennessee gets the shutout. They win it 7-0 and win this series.